Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2024. Today we have received apologies from our convener, Claire Adamson, MSP, and Mark Ruskell, MSP, who are both unable to attend the committee today. We have, as a substitute for Claire Adamson, Jim Fairley, MSP, who is attending, and he has attended the committee before, so there is no need for him to declare any interests. Agenda item one is the review of the EU-UK trade and cooperation agreement, and this is the first session of our review and inquiry. And we are taking evidence this morning in a roundtable format from the Scottish Advisory Forum on Europe, which I think I'll call SAFE, if that's okay. Can I offer a very warm welcome on behalf of the committee to Irene Oldfather, Chair of SAFE, Rachel Lenone, Policy and Public Affairs Officer from SCVO, Agnes Tolmie, Chair of the Scottish Women's Convention, Dr. Adam Marks, International Policy Executive from the Law Society of Scotland, Alistair Sim, Director of University Scotland, Tom Salis, Director of Global Partnerships, Scotch Whisky Association, Lloyd Austin, Convener of the Governance Group from Scottish Environment Link, and Robert Smith, Head of International Policy at the Association of British Pharmaceutical Industry. Can I start by inviting Irene to make a brief opening statement about the work of SAFE, the organisation itself, and also the work in relation to the review of the TCA in particular, and your role within the UK Domestic Advisory Group. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Deputy Convener, and thank you so much for inviting us here today. It's a pleasure to be working with the committee on this, and it's always a pleasure for me to come back and see former colleagues and friends in Parliament, and particularly in the Robert Burns Room, which I had the privilege of nominating Robert Burns as the nominee for this room. So coming from Ayrshire, that's always a special thing. So thank you for that. I thought I would do sort of three things with my opening remarks, and I've been asked to keep them very brief, so I'll try to do it all in about 7 minutes. But I thought I'd tell you a little bit about why we set SAFE up, and I know you've got an excellent briefing from Spice and from Ian there, but just anecdotally to tell you a little bit about why we set SAFE up, about what we've been doing since we were set up, and then say a few words about the context in terms of the TCA review, if that's okay, convener. So SAFE was really set up in response to the setting up of the UK DAG, and when the UK DAG was set up, it was on the basis of expressions of interest, and the first iteration of stakeholders included myself from SCVO, I think Tom from Scotch Whisky Association, Scottish Federation of Fishermen, and so it's quite a limited group, and there was a second iteration that included SCDI, but when I thought about it, and I guess when we collectively thought about it, we thought, you know, this is a limited number of stakeholders to deal with an awful lot of issues in a very wide spectrum. And how could we put together some kind of inclusive forum that would give those who had applied to the DAG but weren't able to become stakeholders, or those who had an interest in the TCA and indeed communities and civil society, how could we find a role for them to input and to give a voice into the DAG work? So there were a lot of bilateral discussions that took place, not least of all with, for example, Anton Muscatelli, who had chaired the First Minister's Standing Council on Europe, just to sense check that there was a gap. And there was a general feeling, I think, across academia, the third sector and business, that we were in kind of a fragmented place, and that I suppose post-Brexit and post-COVID, that we hadn't managed to get together in any kind of inclusive forum. So SAFE was set up, and I guess our membership at the minute sits around somewhere between 35 and 40. It is very much a social partners approach. It's open to trade unions, to the third sector, to business, actually to individuals, and we have that whole range of representation across those stakeholders. Our membership actually is also increasing, and we've recently recruited Enable, which, as members will know, a very powerful organisation speaking on behalf of people with disabilities in Scotland, Health in Mind, and a number of other individuals with an interest in the trade union sector and so on, and the TCA. So in terms of what have we done, well, we agreed our terms of reference, and, you know, that was a big first step. And as I've said, essentially, that was a sort of cross-sectoral social partners approach. We're independent, we're impartial, we're non-political. And we also prepared an information report for the DAG, and that went to the DAG in September, and that was really a collection of views of our stakeholders in relation to the TCA and some early thinking around, you know, what we felt the DAG should be considering and looking at. We held an all-nations conference in conjunction with one of the subgroups of the DAG, and I know that's referred to in your SPICE briefing, that we have five subgroups of the DAG. One of the subgroups is the group on nations and regions, and I convene that with subconveners in Wales, Northern Ireland and England. And we held an all-nations conference, as I say, in Edinburgh in November, and we have a conference report from that, and I'm happy to share that with the committee if it might be of interest, convener. And, you know, there, clearly from that, there was a lot of complementarity around issues that we felt were important going forward, and we had the chair of the DAG at that, speaking about, you know, mutual areas of cooperation. We hosted a visit by the president of the EESC, Oliver Rupka, in November as well, and we signed a memorandum of understanding with the EESC, highlighting particular areas of mutual interest around things like young people, green energy and citizen wellbeing. We've inputted to the work of the Nations and Regions Subcommittee, and the report around that will go to the DAG probably towards the end of February and will form part of a DAG general report, including the work of all of the five subcommittees of the DAG. So we've had input there. Our Straplines, Conversations, Cooperation and Partnership. And, you know, we have very close cooperation. I thought it was worthwhile mentioning this to you, with the EU delegation to the UK in London. And to that end, we've participated in a number of joint events. They held a youth engagement and youth mobility event in London last October. And I actually, as chair of SAFE, chaired three sessions at that, where we had young people from all across the UK, and including a strong cohort from Scotland, actually, talking about, you know, what their ambitions are going forward around youth engagement and how they want to participate and be involved. So I guess we also were involved in a citizens' rights conference that the EU delegation set up in December. And going forward, I feel there might be an opportunity here to have more of these events where Scotland can participate and Scottish stakeholders can be involved. So far it's been youth mobility and citizens' rights. I'd quite like to see one myself on, particularly on trade and SMEs, but, you know, that's up for discussion. Moving to the TCA itself, I suppose what we bring to the table today, I like to think, is, you know, that wide range of participants and stakeholders, but also very much a citizen and community perspective to the work. As you'll know, convener, that frictionless trade is important to the economy, it's important in terms of growth and jobs, but it's also important to communities and to people that collectively we represent, because actually at the end of the day it is about supply and availability of medicines in our pharmacies, it's about the cost of food in our supermarkets, it's about the availability of fresh produce, and it's about safety of goods in our shops. And I think if we look at inequalities in our communities, and we look at some of the start figures around that, we find that in areas of inequality and highest deprivation, one in three food outlets is a fast food outlet, whereas in our areas of our best areas in Scotland, it's one in five. So, you know, there are some stark statistics that support the importance of frictionless trade for consumers and and communities themselves. So finally, what would a revised TCA look like? I think this is quite a difficult question to answer, and I think the answer we might give today could be different from the answer that we would have a year from now. I think if you look, and I had a read again at Article 776 last night, if you look at, you know, what is that TCA review clause, it says that the parties shall jointly review the implementation of the agreement, supplementing agreements, and any related matters thereto 5 years after entry into force of the agreement. I mean, in a way, you could drive a coach and horses through that if you wanted to, although it's review, not revise. You know, what does this mean to matters beyond implementation? And I think it's very, very hard to predict that. There's no doubt in my mind that at this point in time, the European Commission would like to take a very narrow view, a very strict interpretation, because they certainly believe that what we have is a very good agreement. They're very happy with it. And I don't get any strong sense of any desire to expand or revise. But that could change, and, you know, that's about how the EU and the UK, you know, both look to the future. And obviously, you know, this is a year of uncertainty, possible UK election, EU elections and US elections, and all of that could change the climate in which a revised TCA would take place. I think we're trying to take the broadest possible look, you know, aware that in a year things could be different. So what are the kind of key areas that we would want to flag it up out with a very strict implementation of some of the articles of the TCA? But we have a variety of views across the membership. And I think that's a good thing. I'll stop at that, convener. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Irene, for that. It's very helpful. And on that last point, I mean, it's something that we are very cognizant of, in the fact that there are elections, as you said, in both in the EU and the UK, obviously. And I think further, there have been quite strong indications from the EU's perspective, as you say, that they want a very short and rather technical review. So I think it would be quite interesting to garner views across this roundtable on that in particular. We have 2 hours scheduled for this item, but I do want to ensure that everyone around the table can contribute. So can I encourage everyone to keep answers succinct and questions succinct as well? And please don't feel that you have to address every question. You also, from a technical point of view, don't have to press any buttons. That will all be done for you by our broadcast colleagues. We've structured the session into 3 parts. There will obviously, I think, be crossover. The first part is how trade in goods and services between the EU and UK is currently working. Then we'd like to cover where there are challenges and how could these be resolved. And finally, what opportunities are there for further developing the UK-EU relationship. And I think we try and spend around about half an hour to 35 minutes on each of those. So can I start with the first part, which is around trade in goods and services, a kind of temperature check, if you like. And can I ask Mr. Salas this question? Could you tell us broadly what has been the SWA's experience of the TCA to date? And then if others want to come in their respective fields, we'll go like that, please. Thanks.
Sure. Well, thank you, and thank you very much for having me this morning. If you look at our export stats to EU, it's a relatively positive story. So for 2022, our EU exports were up 8% compared to 2019, which I think is a better reference point, given that's before the end of the transition period. And of course, we had a big COVID impact on our export figures. So that suggests that exports have held up well in the EU. We have seen faster growth in the Asia-Pacific region, but that's expected, and APAC has overtaken the EU as our biggest region for exports. In terms of the TCA, we obviously wanted it to deliver as seamless trade as possible with the EU. We also had some other considerations about ensuring the regulatory framework was secure, which was relevant in terms of EU legislation coming onto the UK statute book, which is really important. Considerations about GI protection. Scotch whisky is obviously a geographical indication, so that was important too. But in general, those things were delivered through the TCA. We also had a particular interest in terms of the rollover of EU free trade agreements to the UK, and that was actually really important because, in contrast to the EU, we would have been in line for some tariffs in some non-EU markets had that not been done successfully. So we've avoided some considerable tariffs through those continuity agreements, in particular with Korea being the most important, given the scale of our exports to that market and the fact that 20% tariff would have come in had there not been a continuity agreement. So all of these things have been good for the sector. After the transition period ended, there were definitely some issues around customs clearance. We still do encounter some issues there, and with border delays and with requests for different documentation, which, you know, we can get into in detail later in the session. We've just been trying to work through those as best we can, working with the embassy network in different EU markets, and with Scottish Government SDI support as well to help with those issues. And as you know, with our industry, it's a very collaborative industry, so we've really been, you know, taking a pragmatic approach and just trying to crack on and deal with issues as they've come up. But some markets have been more problematic than others. I think particularly in Southern Europe, Spain, Italy, Portugal, we've had more issues have come up compared to some other markets where it's been very straightforward, actually. So yes, a bit of a mixed picture there. You know, in general, we obviously want to make sure that goods can clear customs quickly and efficiently. It was good for lots of reasons. And we do still encounter some issues with that, but, you know, the number of issues that have been reported has come down as the months have gone by, which is a good sign. And as I go back to the export statistics, you know, they do show a positive picture, whereas I think some other sectors may have had some more challenging issues.
Does anyone else want to come in on their own sector and how the you know, their experience of the TCA has been to date? Please just volunteer. Yep. Adam.
Yeah, I suppose a decent contrast to goods. I mean, the TCA, from our perspective, is very much a goods-focused agreement. But having said that, it does have some useful parts for services. In particular, there is a legal services chapter which allows us to practice international law across the EU in individual member states, and that has been used. And I think, from the point of view of our members, there's sort of two sides to what we're looking at. There's solicitors who are based in Europe and who live there and reside there. And then there is the sort of fly-in, fly-out sort of aspect of legal services, which is very useful because it not only generates for legal services, but it also tends to go alongside a lot of other work. So whether they're trading good or trade in other services such as banking or arbitration, there will be some sort of legal aspect to that, contracts often, for instance. From our side, I think there have been challenges with how the TCA has worked, but I think it is now starting to settle in and people are starting to see the wood for the trees. I think there's still some confusion perhaps and lack of understanding about what is possible everywhere across each member state, and in particular in sort of business mobility, because each member state has its own individual criteria for visas, etc. It has thrown up challenges of knowing what can and can't be done. There have been specific issues to do with Luxembourg, Greece, some bits and bobs in Belgium, for instance, as well, which have started to again come through. I'm happy to go into sort of more detail of some of those later if people are interested. But I think, again, it's sort of a process of moving through. And I think fitting into sort of what Irene was saying about the TCA review process, a lot of these, we've started work on them before the review process. And I sort of have started my point from looking at the TCA that it will be a sort of simple technical review for now. But having said that, a lot of the simple technical things we're already working on. So there's an element of what then is new in the review, and we'll have to see where that develops as elections throw out. But from our side, I think broadly speaking, it's issues to do with, you know, nationality requirements. Do you still get legal privilege? It's all well and good saying you can practice law, but if you don't have privilege, then in meaningful terms, you can't. And that sort of detail, I think, as it shakes through. But happy to talk about any of those in more detail if members are interested.
Robert? Good morning, everybody. By way of quick background, the Association of the British Pharmaceutical Industry represents innovative pharmaceutical companies operating in the UK. So whilst our members are UK companies, we also represent multinationals that have a presence in the UK or manufacturing or researching. The majority of exports from our sector go to the EU, and medicinal and pharmaceutical products are our third largest export. And as I say, many of our companies will have a presence, many if not all, will have a presence in the UK as well as the EU. So we are intrinsically linked. When we look at the pharmaceutical industry, it is on a regional basis. That is how companies structure themselves in order to continue to provide the medicines that people need. The TCA gives us a solid basis for trade with the EU. It includes specific medicines annex with commitments to cooperate, for example, in areas of regulation, which is really critical for our industry. We are highly regulated, and so many of the challenges that our companies face when they trade, it isn't just with goods and customs, it is also about the regulatory environment that they are having to engage with in export markets. We also see really good provisions in the TCA when it comes to cooperation on areas of, for example, intellectual property, on health security, and the customs and rules of origin provisions in there do facilitate movement of goods. The EU and the UK are also both signatories to the WTO pharmaceutical agreement, which allows for tariff-free movement of finished pharmaceutical medicines. So that's not really a challenge for our companies. I think as we move on to the next section, we can talk about some areas of opportunity, certainly where we can further reduce trade frictions. I think it's worth recognising both the UK and the EU throughout the entire process have recognised the importance of medicines as a priority good, in particular in Northern Ireland, which may be outside of the scope of today's conversation, but I think it's really positive to see that there is an appreciation that we're a really complex industry and that we do need some special considerations. There is a working group under the TCA, specifically for medicinal products. I think that recognises the importance of our sector. I think we would really urge both sides to use that as a platform to engage, and also for us to continue to engage through the domestic advisory group with the UK government, identifying areas of further opportunity to reduce trade barriers and frictions in the goods that we trade.
Yes, Lloyd.
Thank you, Convener. Scottish Environment Link is obviously mostly concerned about environmental issues and environmental regulations that lead to action on climate change and biodiversity crisis, etc. And from that perspective, they're all international issues. And they're issues that are best addressed cooperatively. And to some extent, therefore, we're more concerned about the cooperation part of the trade and cooperation agreement, but I'll come back to that more later, perhaps. But in particular, one aspect of it is where it talks about the level playing field and fair competition and that impact on trade. And, you know, in that regard, we're quite interested in whether there is divergence in terms of environmental regulation and whether that divergence is as a result of a race to the top between jurisdictions, which is what we would support, or a race to the bottom and trying to undercut each other's jurisdiction, which would be, you know, counterproductive from an environmental point of view. Perhaps I'll come back to divergence in environmental issues a bit later, but I just wanted to flag up one particular trading part of that has an importance in relation to action on climate change, and that's the electricity trading arrangements that are, and that the TCA set a deadline for what's called alternative day-ahead trading arrangements to have been designed and implemented by April 2022. That was missed, and so we'd very much like to see the UK and the EU agree that alternative trading arrangement as soon as possible. And the TCA also committed both sides to give serious consideration to linking the UK ETS and the EU ETS to enable both British and EU market participants access to that kind of far larger liquid market, and which in our view would enable a more cost-effective delivery of the changes to the electricity market that's needed to meet net zero. And if that was agreed, it would also remove the need for the carbon border adjustment mechanism, which is an issue in itself. But if you dealt with the trading arrangements for electricity, then you wouldn't need that at all. So that's the one trading thing that has a very much a knock-on impact into environmental issues. But if you allow me, I'll come back to divergence more later. And
I just want to bring Jim in at this point.
It can be, and this may be a really stupid question because I'm new to this subject today. What are the implications of missing the deadline of the Electricity Trading Cooperation?
I think that's up to the two parties, the EU and the UK, as to whether or not they take each other, how they, whether they go to arbitration or anything like that, I don't know. I think it gets referred to the joint committees and issues like that. But I mean, the best way of addressing it is to do the deal that the TCA suggested they wanted to.
Thank you.
Yes, Agnes.
When we've consulted with the Scottish Women's Convention, I've consulted with women across Scotland. Some of the issues that are raised under the trades and goods services are like the supply chains can sometimes just break, and we have medicines in short supply, for example. So we believe that these are things that with a bit of goodwill and hard work we can fix for our families and communities in Scotland. But big concerns are around jobs and food and these types of issues. The women in the NFU, the National Farmers Union, are telling us that they're really concerned about the animal welfare, and going back to previous topics about things like pesticides, and we're seeing the EU withdrawing again, backing off from their commitment to not use these pesticides. So these are women who are concerned about that. But young women in particular are concerned about their opportunities for the future. There was projects like Erasmus or Erasmus Plus we were promised, and young women had seen a future in Europe that they still believe can happen with the will of this government, the Scottish government, that we can build bridges. And I'll give you some examples of the opportunities that we've seen. We run a number of conferences over the year on a range of topics. Most of them have a keynote speaker from the Scottish government. So we ran a STEM conference and about how women are regarded and how we get more women into the actual jobs. And we've made a link with Denmark. They came in online, women from Denmark. Now, we're not funded to do that work, but what we can do is we can advocate for women in that situation. But what we also do is we introduce them so organisations in Scotland, women's organisations, can move forward with organisations in Denmark around STEM subjects. Young women were looking at working with education organisations in Spain and Portugal to get young women into that, but that's not our role, and that's why it's all a bit ad hoc, and it would be really good if we could start to formalise some of these things at a different level. Violence against women is a big topic, and this particular Scottish Government's record is very good on the work that we've done for violence against women. But in France, they've come up with some fantastic initiatives, and we've been working with them. But although it's at a distance and informal, but it's something that we're doing. And again, we can put organisations in touch with the organisations in France. So we see that there's a lot of opportunities, and while we still have huge regrets about the decision to leave the EU, there are still some challenges that we believe we can overcome, and a lot of opportunities that government and the organisations, civil society, can become involved in and build these new bridges. But we have to get away from the ad hoc, informal approaches, and I think that's what women are telling us. I can get into more detail if you want, but I know you don't like me to talk for too long.
Then if anyone of our guests would like to come in, Aaron, yeah.
Just a couple of very brief comments. One is around the, I think, probably unintended consequences, but perhaps not, I'm not really sure, but it's about the interoperability of customs administration charges for citizens. So, for example, if you send a small gift to someone in, anywhere in the EU, there is usually a customs charge for picking that gift up from the post office. And we have heard from various stakeholders across Scotland and actually England about relationships being severed because of these customs charges, because they can be up to €35 in what could be, for example, a birthday gift, a pair of tartan socks, a scarf or something like that. And you know, people don't know what's in the gift, but they're being asked €35 to pick the gift up. And so there's an interoperability question too, because it's not consistent in every member state. So we're operating a lot of different systems here. And I think it's, you know, it's a barrier in terms of citizens, and part of what we want to do today is bring citizens into this conversation. So I wanted to mention that. And also, as you know, Scottish NFU couldn't be here today because it's their annual conference, and I'm sure over the course of your deliberations you will hear a lot about sanitary and phytosanitary measures, and in particular seed potatoes. And I suppose to add alongside that, you know, we've heard from some of the big companies, but for small SMEs who really don't have a lot of manpower around understanding the complexity of customs and administration, you know, there are issues around how we can simplify some of these procedures. It's something that the DAG has raised, and to be fair, there have been you know, educational seminars held with small and medium-sized enterprises to allow them to ask questions and to get help and support. But I do think it's something that we need to keep a close eye on going forward. And certainly for us in Scotland, the seed potato issue, where we've had seed potatoes that are disease-free for, you know, 50-plus years, unlike other countries, and in actual fact we're caught up in some of this around the regulations. So I think these are a few issues that others, if they were here, might bring to the table, so I'm just raising on their behalf.
Can I bring in Kate Forbes? Kate.
Thanks very much. Maybe a bit of a political question, but obviously SAFE have identified a number of areas where you'd like to see progress, so either programmes to join or new provisions and regulations being made. And in some cases, that's been more successful than others in terms of horizon, but then outstanding programmes that you still want to participate in. Do you think that where there has been movement, it has been because of the effective consultation with civic society, or is it pure politics?
Well, very good question. And sitting where I am, I feel that civil society is actually leading the debate in a lot of these areas, to be honest. And you know, I've said that for quite some time now. Certainly on Horizon, we lobbied very hard on that. And one of our members of SAFE, actually, is the Chief Scientist for Scotland, Anna Dominicek, and she's an emeritus professor at Glasgow as well, and has led Horizon programmes in the past when we were members of the European Union. And you know, one of the asks that we had around Horizon was not just that we would participate as a third country, but also, and it was really at the behest of Anna, who has, as I say, led a lot of these programmes in the past, that we could actually lead on some of the programmes. So there was quite a strong lobby around that and a successful one. So, you know, whether that was politics or civil society, you know, I'd like to think that certainly civil society and some of our experts is something that would be very important to our universities in Scotland. And you know, Alistair may want to comment on this. But and what I hope is that that opens a door to other things, and I don't know if we'll come on and speak about it later, but certainly in the sessions that I led in London, and one was with Scottish young people, there is a very strong desire to open the door in other areas around things like school exchanges. I mean, there are some bilateral programmes going on at the minute between the UK and France. But I think it gets to a tipping point where if you have enough bilateral, you should actually have a framework around this. And so I would really like to see us, you know, and that's part of what SAFE is. It's about, you know, conversations, cooperation and partnership. And I suppose I'm veering into opportunities here, convener, but, you know, I do think there are opportunities around this. And I hope that, that Horizon and the work that civil society did around that programme and very successful in the sense that we can actually lead Horizon projects as well as just participate in them, which is very, very important for our innovators and scientists in Scotland. And I hope that opens the door to other possible opportunities. And, you know, Erasmus is a very clear and pressing one, but it's not just about further and higher education. You know, recent discussions we've had with business, they're very keen to see young people. They don't want this to be just about further and higher education. They want to see young people in apprenticeships. They want to see young people in exchanges. So I think there are opportunities around this. And certainly I feel there's a strong desire. You know, I mentioned that we have an MOU with the European Economic and Social Committee. They're very interested in doing this, and they have an opinion at this point in time on young people. And it's going to the plenary in April and the committee at the beginning of April. And I think, you know, there's a strong desire on the European Union side of this to take this forward. So I hope that that provides a template almost, Ms. Forbes, for doing other things. And certainly from a civil society, I can't speak from the political perspective, but from a civil society perspective, we're keen to keep opening that door.
Heartening, because it means that there is the potential for change, and so your participation really matters. And I wonder, therefore, I don't know if anyone else wants to speak to it, but whether others have equal levels of optimism and hope that their participation too might result in change.
Thank you. Can I bring in Alistair, who hasn't yet spoken, because I think we had touched on both Erasmus and Horizon. So
thank you, Raj, and really responding to Kate Forbes' point on, you know, what's the combination between the sort of the pressure of civil society and the politics. I think that's interesting. I'll maybe reflect briefly on Horizon and Erasmus in that context. I think what was extremely powerful in, you know, eventually getting us over the line with the full Horizon Association was that there was a conjunction of voices from Scotland, the wider UK and the EU, all saying to UK government and to the European authorities, you know, please, 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 can we get this association agreement over a line? I mean, we had very, very strong support from European Universities Association, League of European Research Universities and so on. I think that sort of collective voice from both sides, from the UK and from civil society and academic leadership in Europe, was very powerful, and eventually, you know, subject to agreeing the cost of associating, that made it possible. And actually, we were quite lucky that the Minister of State for Science at the time in the UK government was also a huge enthusiast for Horizon Association and worked very hard to get that over the line. Doesn't always work, though. I think, you know, on Erasmus, I think, again, there had been sort of very strong voices, you know, from Scotland, from the wider UK, and from European civil society partners, that it would be a great thing if we could keep the UK fully in Erasmus Plus. It would just help, you know, build what the sort of living bridge between Europe and the UK of people who've been abroad, who've understood each other's cultures and circumstances. And so it was really disappointing not to get that. I think that, you know, but I think ultimately that was probably driven by price. I think basically when UK government looked at what it would cost to be in Erasmus Plus, they stepped back. I mean, our hope would be that you know, as we renew our relationship with the EU, that actually associating to Erasmus Plus or whatever its successor is a high priority. I think, you know, obviously I speak for the university sector. It's been great for student mobility. It's been great for staff mobility and collaboration, but it has got a wider value to civil society that you know, we recognise and would like to see replicated. So, yeah, it's interesting. I think there's a mixture between civil society, peer pressure from both sides of the UK and Europe, politics and money.
Can I bring in Rachel here again?
Yeah, just briefly to keep on that, the summit we had in November with EU representative, I think there was a strong recognition from them that the relationship had improved, and so now was the time we could open new conversations, I think. And the other point I wanted to make on that was, like, thanks to Irene, we do have SAFE in Scotland, but we're actually ahead of other nations with that forum, because we're starting to organise ourselves as a civil society, which is not happening in other nations, and I think they would like to have the same. So I think it's important to note that one, because that type of cooperation and collaboration is what we need going forward.
Robert, did you want to come in on this?
Very briefly, on the horizon point, I think it is worth recognising as well that that was a commitment by both sides within the trade and cooperation agreement. What we saw was a lag between the commitment once the deal was signed and implementation of some of these things. And I think that's a really critical lens to see some of this through, is that sometimes the challenge isn't about renewing or getting to new agreements on areas of cooperation. It is also about implementing what has been agreed. When you talk about optimism, I think what we can reflect is that Horizon Europe and the UK's association followed closely behind the Windsor Framework for Northern Ireland. And certainly for the pharmaceutical industry, what that provided was long-term certainty for our companies. So I think we are seeing things move in the right direction, again, with a recognition that for some of these issues, as we get further away from the negotiation of the TCA and look more into implementation, there are shared areas of opportunity, Horizon being one of the most obvious and high profile.
I'd like to bring in some other colleagues. Keith.
Thanks very much. It's been quite heartening, but also surprising to hear the extent to which people are fairly sanguine about these things and are working through solutions, which is good to know. But we've got some big players around the table. And the reason it's surprising is because it's quite discordant. I mean, I this week was contacted by a small firm in Kintyre, whose business has been essentially decimated because they can't export the fish, cooked fish products that they have. So the difference between some of the big players who know how to get around government and make sure they prosecute their interests quite legitimately, and the vast majority of businesses in Scotland, which are small, medium enterprises, is quite a stark one. I don't know whether that's, because Irene mentioned it when she spoke about SMEs, is that an area that you listen to, that you've got some feedback on? Because that seems to be quite a different experience. As best I can gather, most MSPs will have heard about, and you read it in the media, which doesn't necessarily mean it's true, but you read it, there's major issues in terms of small businesses and the way they've been impacted and how they can try and work their way through things like the TCA, which for small businesses can be a huge challenge.
Irene, do you want to take that one?
Yeah. I mean, I absolutely agree with you, Keith. I think you know, one of the interesting pieces of research around this is from British Chambers of Commerce, and Scottish Chambers of Commerce are members of SAFE, and I know you're going to be hearing from them later on, but British Chambers of Commerce produced a report in December which showed that about half of businesses had felt that they didn't feel things had improved in the last year, and that for SMEs the complexity around this was quite a challenge. So that was why I mentioned it, and I would draw your attention. I was looking through my notes for that report, I would draw your attention to it, convener, because you know there was a very important survey done, and it did show that almost two-thirds of exporters to the EU say that trade with the EU is more difficult than it was a year ago, and that was done in July 2023, so you know it related to 2022 to 2023. You know, perhaps there has been more confidence since July 2023, but this is certainly a very good report, and I think worth the committee spending some time reviewing. But it does have all the statistics I think that you're thinking of, Keith, that we hear about, you know, from particularly from small businesses who don't have the sort of powerful research departments and opportunities to engage with DG Trade and so on, and you know it is important that they have a voice in this too. Thanks.
I think Tom wants to come in on this point too.
I mean, I agree. From our perspective, we've got 93 member companies. That does include a lot of small distillers in our membership, and I think it's fair to say that when challenges have come up around border processes or requests for certification, it's particularly SMEs which can struggle with those. They might not have the in-house capacity to run out some of these certificates or to get them externally produced. The cost of an external certificate can run into hundreds of pounds. So that is a problem. There have definitely been some issues around sending samples as well, which is particularly important for small businesses, particularly new distillers, new entrants to the industry when they're trying to get their product out there to potential customers. Cross-border e-commerce is another one, and that refers to the point that Irene made earlier about kind of small packages. Anything needing to be sent in a small quantity can run into issues. Now, over time, I think the number of issues has gone down, but it's still a challenge, and we've seen a lot of our companies adjusting their distribution, their route to market to try and get around those challenges. But I do agree that when you're talking about border processes and problems at the border, it's SMEs that particularly can struggle.
Does anyone else want to comment on this particular issue that Keith raised before I go to Alexander then? Thank you.
Thank you very much for your frankness and honestness so far this morning. I mean, you've all talked about the frustrations that your sectors or your industry or your organisations have suffered in this process. But the optimism that is there is also quite encouraging to see, because your willingness to adapt, your willingness to cooperate, your willingness to understand will be the success from all of this. But it's what asks that you need now that we are so far down the road. You know, the things may be more optimistic, things may be improving, but what do we need next to happen to ensure that your industries, your sectors and your organisations do have the capability of moving forward in the uncertainties that you've already identified. Because, as I say, each and every one of you have the knowledge, the wealth, the experience, the understanding of what needs to be acquired. But is there an issue from politics that needs to deal with next? Is there a next stage that you need to see us and organisations do to impart that and to give you that optimism and the prospect of going forward?
Do you want to take that question? Robert.
I mean, I'm happy to start. I think, absolutely, there are opportunities that our industry has identified, and I think we obviously recognise that the terms of the TCA, whilst providing a foundation, do also provide opportunities to build. One of the key ones is an operational ask, which we hope will sort of move forward in the next couple of months, and it's the medicinal products working group that I mentioned. I think, frankly, just having a platform for both sides to exchange information is really valuable. There are, I think, about three specific working groups for big sectors. The other is automotive and organic chemicals. And I think that recognises the importance of those sectors to both sides. That has yet to formally meet, the Medicinal Products Working Group, and I think we think that in moving in the right direction should be meeting in the next couple of months, but we'd really urge the UK government and the Scottish government, if they can support, to use that platform to properly have conversations about areas of opportunity and to engage with the sectors and the businesses that are trading and know what the sort of challenges are on the ground. So I think that is number one in terms of operational. The second for us is, I mentioned regulation being a really important part for our sector. And we have a medicinal products annex in the TCA, which does give us lots of areas of cooperation and recognition. But one of the big ones that we don't have is recognition of batch testing of medicines. And so very briefly to explain, when a batch of medicines is produced and comes off the production line, you have to test it to make sure that it is safe and effective. And those certificates are then used to give confidence to export when you're exporting it to other countries. Now, often what you'll do is you will batch test the product when it is manufactured, say in the UK, and then when you export it to another country, it will be tested again. What we have seen is in economies where they have really strong, highly developed regulatory regimes, such things as mutual recognition agreements, which is where both sides recognise that the tests one does won't have to be done again, that they trust the other side is good enough. And the UK has these sorts of agreements with the US, with Switzerland, with Australia. We don't have that with the EU. And so you're in a situation where if you are manufacturing a product in the UK and you batch test it, you move it across the border, it has to be batch tested again before it can be placed on the market. And that adds friction into the system. It adds cost to businesses. It adds cost to regulators because regulators have to, you know, in some cases, verify or keep an eye on some of this activity. So there are some really practical things where even outside of the TCA, these sorts of agreements can be struck. And both the UK and EU recognise, as I've talked about a lot, the importance of medicines and supply. We hope that through things like this medicinal products working group, both sides can sit down and have a frank and technical conversation about what they need to get to in order to agree agreements such as this.
Yes, Adam.
Say, in terms of sort of one big broad message, what do we need? I think the sort of overall thing I try to remember is that trade deals don't end when they're signed. And certainly from the point of view of services, implementation is always going to be where the actual value is gained. And I think there is always the excitement of chasing the next deal rather than just dealing with what we've already signed, and whether this is true for whether it's the deals we've got with Australia and New Zealand as much as the TCA. And I think there is some good work being done on that. For instance, I mean, in terms of implementation of the TCA, we've had some very good cooperative work between the UK government, the Scottish government, ourselves, the other bars and law societies around the UK on issues we've faced in Luxembourg, which has sort of now moved to the extent that the Luxembourg Parliament has passed a bill to sort of fix some of the issues surrounding nationality requirements of solicitors in Luxembourg, which has been very helpful. And we're still, I think, moving towards sort of positive outcomes, perhaps in Greece and some of the issues we've had, more minor, but there in Belgium. In terms of specific asks for the TCA and looking forwards in that, I think really the sort of two big ones, which I think do fit into the review process, which would be quite good. Article 145 has some specific obligations on transparency, and effectively it's just understanding what people can do. What are the visa requirements? How long can you go for? How much does it cost? What documentations do you need? Yeah, simple things. Can it be filed electronically? Do you need to go to a consulate? And having sort of a central repository of that information would be very useful on both sides, I think. And I think there's a sort of willingness to tackle that. And I think even before we get to a formal review, there has been moves on both the UK side and the Commission side to start trying to pool that information. But inevitably, again, recognising the deal has been relatively recently signed and big picture stuff, that will take some time to shake through. But I think it's a constructive process. The other one I would ask for specifically is under Article 126, which is about short-term business visitors. You can actually, on that occupation list, add legal services, which would obviously be useful for legal services in general. I think it would also be useful for other things, because it means you can take your lawyer with you, effectively, as opposed to having to move from place to place and worry about it. So, again, that sort of argument that, you know, solicitors and legal services actually kind of are the lubricant to a lot of other business. It just makes life easier if you can fly across borders and do that.
Thank you. I want to bring in Lloyd and then Alistair. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Kavina. My answer to your question is going to be I would quite like an answer to the question that Jim Fairley asked me earlier, is, you know, what does civil society do if? And I want to explain why I'd like to know the answer to that question, and that is that in the TCA, in Chapter 7, which is the environment and climate chapter, it talks about non-regression and maintaining levels of protection for the environment, etc. But what we have is that we're beginning to see divergence between the EU and the UK, and the Institute for European Environment Policy published a very good report just this month on divergence in environmental regulation, particularly divergence in ambition. There's a number of examples in there, and I would certainly recommend the committee look at that for sort of issues from the environment point of view. One of the key areas relates to chemicals and whether or not the UK reach, which is really a GB reach because of Northern Ireland being under the protocol type arrangements. The number of chemicals that the EU has added to sort of watch lists, ones that need to be assessed for risk, etc., over since we left the EU has been quite significant, whereas the UK has added nothing. So there's increasing divergence. And what that does do is, it from a trade point of view, it potentially leads to unfair competition. But from an environmental point of view, which is where I'm coming from, it obviously leads to risk to the environment and so on. And it leads to the race to the bottom rather than a race to the top, which is what we would like to see. But the question really in terms of what happens next is what can one do about it, as Jim Fairley asked earlier. From a civil society point of view, we're very pleased that there are environmental NGOs on both the UK DAG and the EU DAG. EEB is the representative on the EU one, and the Green Alliance is the representative on the UK one. And that's very welcome, but it's early days. But what we can raise issues there, but the question we don't really understand is what happens to the issue we raised. What is the responsibility on the UK and the EU to do anything about the issues that the civil society representatives raise? And what opportunities are there for civil society to say to the UK or the EU, you're not sticking to what you've promised in the DAG, in the TCA. So if you promised, as Chapter 7 does, to maintain levels of environment protection, and one of the parties doesn't, what can civil society do about it? The issue I raised earlier about electricity trading, there was a deadline for agreement and not was reached. So what can we do about it? So looking at those implementation issues, as Adam said earlier, I think is a big one for going forward and for the review process.
Alistair, I think you wanted to come.
Let me just pick, in response to Alexander Stewart's questions about opportunities for deepening this relationship as we go forward. I think a few. I mean, not all of them are specific around the renegotiation with TCA. I think some of them also require the evolution of UK policy. I do think I would put mobility of talent absolutely top, and making sure that we've got good arrangements for people to be able to move across borders, particularly university staff, researchers, teachers, but also students, because I think that's just the lifeblood of academia, as people being able to collaborate, being able to move freely, exchange ideas. And I think on the EU side, just more freedom for people to spend more time in the EU when they're doing these collaborative projects or when they're studying, and a visa regime that makes that as easy as possible for mobility of talent, for collaboration with European partners, and obviously in the other direction, making it as easy as possible for EU talent to come here, making sure that we're not, with things like health surcharge, visa costs, and with restrictions on entitlement to bring dependents, we're already setting up barriers that, for instance, make it quite difficult for someone as an early career researcher, a postdoctoral researcher, for instance, to choose to come to the UK. Erasmus, we've talked about already. I think, you know, it'd be great if we can find a way back into that as we renegotiate the relationship with our European partners. And I think recognition of qualifications, obviously, you know, Law Society have touched on this already. There are some things in place that are helpful, but just getting to a stage where there's a general co-recognition of qualifications between the EU and UK, I think would be fantastic, so that, for instance, if you qualify as an engineer or as an architect at a Scottish university, you are recognised as an engineer or an architect throughout the EU.
Do you want to bring in Neil and then Jim on this particular point?
Thanks. Can I just ask about Erasmus? Obviously, I think it's very regrettable that we, you know, no longer part of the Erasmus Plus programme. You've talked about the benefits this morning, and others, Alistair, from that, and it's well made. You said earlier that the really it was the UK government looking at the cost that was prohibitive. How much are the costs involved in that in terms of weighing up the costs and benefits of the policies? And apologies, I might be just jumping the gun slightly on this, but if there's not a prospect of joining Erasmus Plus in full, is there anything that would stop short of that that we could potentially do that would improve the situation right now for universities and students both in Scotland, the UK and the EU?
Okay, well, thank you. I don't think there is a publicly available figure for what it would have cost for us to buy into Erasmus Plus as the UK, but I think you know, it was sort of hundreds of millions, if not billions. It was a large amount of money that a UK government that felt itself to be facing a degree of financial crisis didn't feel it could invest at that stage. You know, what one would hope that as part of renegotiating a TCA, looking towards, you know, an affordable mechanism for us to be in Erasmus Plus or whatever successors there are as fully as possible would be really good. I mean, obviously, we have at both UK and Scottish level, you know, tried to introduce mitigations. The Turing scheme is, you know, it's not perfect. There's a lot of administrative difficulties. It only supports mobility one way, but nonetheless, you know, across Scotland's universities and colleges and, you know, anyone else who can participate in it, in the last year for virtue of data, you know, over 3,500 people were using it, and that's not uncomparable to the numbers of students who were going out from Scotland under Erasmus. But it's kind of clunky. The administration's not great, and it just doesn't open as many opportunities as Erasmus Plus did. And we now obviously have the pilot of a Scottish-European exchange programme from Scottish Government. I think that was kind of inspired by seeing what was being done in Wales under a TITHE scheme to try and promote two-way student mobility in particular, youth mobility more generally. That's at the moment that's really so small, it's kind of hard to reach a judgment. I think it's very much proof of concept. I think the Scottish Government will need to evaluate that and decide, you know, whether that's worth developing further, whether it's good value for money in relation to other things that you know, frankly, having faced funding cuts, that universities are prioritising. But there, you know, there are mitigations being developed. But you know, I think we would all, in an ideal world, want to be as fully participating in Erasmus Plus and its successors as possible.
Thank you.
I'm glad you mentioned the new pilot programme and the TITHE scheme, because I think the Royal Society of Edinburgh have said that the Scottish Government scheme is on a much smaller scale than the TITHE scheme. But Jim, do you want to?
It was just a very brief point. You were talking about the barriers for European citizens to come here, and you outlined some of them. Is there the same level of or high bar of participation for UK folk going into Europe as there is the other way about?
I think it's a bit different. I mean, I think the problem in Europe, for instance, is the limit on the number of days you can stay there visa-free. I mean, just things have just become more frictionful. I don't think it's really a question of cost. I think we've put quite a lot of cost barriers in the way of mobility of talent. But I think for the EU, it's more that we now have a much more restricted entitlement to actually spend time in EU countries on a visa-free basis, which just it's just another bit of friction in the mobility of talent.
Okay, thank you.
Aaron, do you want to come in?
Yes, I'm picking up a couple of Mr. Stewart's point, and I suppose following on from Lloyd's remarks, I mean, for me there's something around governance. So the specialist committees are part of the engine room of how we look at this, and I think it's really important that audit, monitor and review role. And some of this, it feels to me, could be dealt with in the specialist committees. But I get the sense that they're not working as well as they could be and that it's very variable. I think there's one committee didn't meet last year. One committee met twice and the others met on an ad hoc basis. And for me, there should be a kind of stricter governance around this. I mean, I think all of us around the table, I'm on the ambulance board, and we have get very strict sort of risk registers, and all of us here have agendas, and the agendas are published so many days in advance. The minutes follow through the meeting. They're published online. They're transparent. And I would like to see some consistency brought to the specialist committees, because to go back to the article 776 and how you interpret that, not everything has to be a revision of the TCA. And some of the things that we're talking about just now could be by mutual agreement. And the specialist committees could play a role in that. But it seems to me there isn't a coherent governance around it. That's just as an outsider to this. And I feel that some kind of more rigorous application of a governance structure around what is the engine room of this, sitting alongside the DAG and the PPA, could give more rigour to how we resolve some of the issues without necessarily having to revise the TCA. And of course, it takes two to tango. It is about the UK and the EU wanting to resolve some of these issues. And we did speak about seed potatoes. And I mean, the UK government has refused to dynamically align to the EU SPS, and the EU is unwilling to grant a derogation. So, everybody's a bit at loggerheads. And I think if we had more conflict resolution opportunities around the governance structures, then perhaps we could reach resolution on some of these issues. That's quite a subjective perspective, I have to say, convener, but it just seems to me, looking in on this, that there could be more. I think Tom's agreeing there. He might have further insight.
I think it's a good point. I think all of us have collectively raised a lot of issues now through the DAG process, and some of those have found their way onto specialised committee agendas. I think now we're at the time where it's good for there to be rigorous follow-up and just check to what extent these issues are really being addressed. I think for us this year is an opportunity for us to get clarity, particularly regarding some of the border issues that I've referred to before. Can we get consistent application in certain markets? It's much easier for companies if they know what the requirements are, even if there's a bit of a burden in doing so, than the product actually landing at a port in the EU and then being held there while people run around trying to find a document that is being asked for, which we weren't expecting. And as I said, those issues have gone down, but they've not completely gone away. And, that's where I think there's an opportunity to use the specialised committees to kind of raise these issues and follow up with the relevant markets and see if we could get some improvements. So I'd fully support that. I mean, there are obviously other means as well. You've got the WTO committees, which provide an opportunity for the government to raise issues regarding EU policy. I think there's an interesting point about future EU policy. you know, there's very well raising concerns about the situation at the moment, but there's also a lot of really important stuff coming down the line in Brussels as well. So how is the government going to raise concerns about those as well? I really support the point around the specialised committees. And maybe there should also be other kind of dialogues on a regulator-to-regulator basis. I think you refer to a few working groups that exist for some sectors, but not for others. Maybe there's more to do in that area as well.
The convener, Claire Adamson, and I both are observer members on the PPA, which, as you'll know, meets twice a year in the UK and the EU. And the role of the specialised committees is very much on the agenda there, and issues about how frequently they're meeting, how they're operating are very live. Can I bring in Agnes, please? Thank you.
Thank you, convener. I was wanting to come in on the comments made by Neil Bibby about the Erasmus. I mean, there is no doubt from the work that we've done that young people in Scotland want to be part of developing what a future Scotland looks like, what kind of Scotland that they want to live in. And that is, it's an added benefit for them to be involved in these type of projects. It helps them develop the skills that they need for the future, how to work collaboratively, and how the learning other languages and how to interact. And they bring the skills back to our country and develop them there. But it isn't all just about business. And I think that sometimes we can take our eye off that particular ball. I mean, Scotland, the revival in Scottish music and culture that we are sending out to the world, but embracing other nations' culture and music and arts has to play a fundamental part in any civilised society. So that's where the benefits of these organisations and programmes can help us. So I would argue that the benefit would outweigh the cost anyway for us to have a nice, better future Scotland.
One of the remits of this committee is obviously culture. It's in our title, and it's something that we cover as a committee, particularly the Scottish culture in Europe, but also European culture coming to Scotland. So it's very pertinent. Yes, Keith, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I would agree with that. And back in the midst of time when I did an exchange course as a student, it was out with the EU, but you gain a huge amount from it. Just talking about that and just some of the points that Mr. Salas has made about the WTO being a way to influence the EU kind of indirectly, and also your earlier comments about Korea and the Asian Pacific region. The other side of this all, of course, is the absence of trade agreements with countries around the world for the UK now, and one or two that have been signed, which people say New Zealand and so on, are pretty disastrous, actually. What has been the impact of the absence of those, because previously it would have been under the EU, the absence of those trade agreements, is there any impact from that on exports, trade, otherwise?
So from our perspective, for Scottish Music Industries' perspective, a lot of important continuity agreements were signed, and there was a degree of involvement of the UK and EU with third countries to make sure that that happened. And that was very welcome for us because that prevented tariffs from coming in where they weren't there because of the EU free trade agreements. Lots of examples in the Americas region. I mentioned South Korea earlier, South Africa. So we really welcomed that. In terms of the UK's independent trade policy agenda, I mean, it's hugely important for us as we're a big export industry, as you would expect. We're eagerly awaiting something on India. Understand that negotiations are at very advanced stages, so we've got our fingers crossed on that one as the absolute priority. 150% import tariff obviously impacting our Scotch whisky going into the Indian market, and we only have about a 2% share of the total Indian market, so the opportunity there is huge, as well as the rest of the FTA agenda. So we fully support the efforts to get trade agreements over the line. We appreciate it is not easy, not an easy exercise, but we certainly do all we can to give the government our support and technical input on the negotiations.
Can I bring in Rachel, please?
It was just to go back to the previous question on the ask, and I think that the key is around clarity and transparency, really, and understanding what are the implications on all of us, because we all have a job. I mean, SCVO has a job to do with their members, informing them of what's happening. But we need that information, and at the moment, it's just very difficult to understand the impact that could have on people, really, because we all, you know, consumers, producers, we're all citizens, and we all have the rights to have that information. And then it leads to this bigger question. So if you look at the EU settlement scheme, for example, it wasn't perfect. You had some information. I mean, I had to do it, so I can speak from personal experience. I was one of the lucky ones who had no issues with it. But you still have people today who needed support, who are being found being in a very difficult situation because they didn't have the application done. And you need support from organisations, usually from the voluntary sector, like Citizen Rights Project. Those organisations need to be funded to do that job. And there's a question, broader question here around the sustainability of the voluntary sector in providing support when needed. Because that comes on top of everything else, like cost of living, fundraising issues, volunteer shortages. So I think it's part of a bigger picture. We need to keep that in mind as well.
Irene, do you want to come back on that?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I suppose following on from Rachel's points there too, that at the Nations and Regions conference that we had, where we were looking at funding, I mean, the Shared Prosperity Fund, I think it would be fair to say, hasn't fulfilled expectations. And we're about to finalise our report on the Nations and Regions Subcommittee, and I'm aware that, for example, in relation to Wales, that there's a kind of touring plus, 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 you might say, and we're going to be using that as a case study. And I'm aware that using the word touring, I think, is a little bit off-putting, because this is much more advanced than touring. I do hope there is scope for something, whether it's between a touring plus 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 and an Erasmus plus or something like that. And I think we have to also look at what economists now will consider in terms of the social return on investment. So I think it's not just about the spend, but it's about the social return that you get for that. And I mean, I know in the third sector, we've analysed some of our work in relation to that kind of approach around social return on investment. It's very surprising, just the added value that, you know, culture, the education and third sector can bring if you look at it through that slightly different lens. So I wanted to mention that and the case study that we'll be flagging up around, you know, the sort of touring plus plus, or I think it's called Tithe in the Welsh case study. To flag up the Shared Prosperity Fund as, I think, requiring a bit of adjustment. It hasn't met the expectations. And I know that, for example, in Wales, third sector organisations have literally closed because of the changes to funding. And, you know, that's not necessarily a good thing.
Robert.
Mr. Brown's questions about trade, and I think similar to Tom outlining, what we see is that the UK rolled over lots of existing agreements that we had when we were a member of the EU, and those largely kept the terms of trade with those partners the same. What the UK is now doing is starting proper negotiations with a view to have a new sort of deal with some of these partners. Ones that spring to mind, South Korea, Switzerland, certainly for our sector, we see that there is opportunity for the UK to look at the terms of the deals that maybe were signed 10, 15 years ago, to update it and bring it into line with best practice for the important sectors of the economy, particularly when we look at regulatory cooperation, when we look at supporting innovation. When it comes to the WTO as well, it's worth recognising that the UK now has an independent seat. And that provides us with the opportunity to use things like trade policy reviews, to use our voice to uphold the WTO system, but also to use the committees that we've talked about to go further in some of these agreements and really push for areas that are good for the UK and the economy as we are constituted. So in short, there is continuity for the most part when it comes to trade, and there are opportunities now that we're looking again at those deals to see how we can go further than perhaps the EU did. We did when we were a member of the EU.
Yeah, of course.
If that's the case, if there are these opportunities which could be exploited, we're now, I don't know how many years since we had Brexit, those opportunities have not been realised because the big ones, we've not done a deal with the US, with Canada. I'm much less optimistic about India than Mr. Salas is, to be honest. I think the Modi's made it fairly clear we're not going to do that anytime soon. So those opportunities have been missed the longer and longer this goes on. If the opportunities are there, we're missing out on them because it's not happening. And we were told these would happen very quickly. I suppose that's my concern, really.
Let's come back on that. Either of you?
On the point about continuity, I think, is the most important part, which is that what we haven't seen is, because of the rollovers of agreements, there hasn't necessarily been a direct and immediate change in the trading relationships that we had.
So, when I started, I said we were going to try and have three sort of separate themes, and I think we've overlapped quite a lot on the first and the second ones. The second one was about challenges and how these could be resolved, and we've discussed a wide variety of different challenges and potential solutions. So just to draw that part to a close, does anyone else have anything they'd like to add around the current challenges and potential solutions? Yes, Adam.
Just very briefly, referring to sort of what Irene said earlier on governance, I think in the broader structures of the governance of all of the trade agreements that we have, we are slowly moving towards a position where we have a bit more clarity around how all of that works. The UK government has just done another reform of the various bodies that guide into that, and I think that's useful. But knowing precisely who is doing what, particularly sort of so in our case specifically, if you're dealing with the TCA, parts of it are handled by DBT, parts of it by MOJ, parts of it by the FCDO, and parts of it by the Scottish Government. And I think we are slowly now starting to get a feeling for what goes where. But that process will take time. I think reform of that as we move forward is useful. The other one I'd just comment purely from our point of view is that both ourselves and the Faculty of Advocates applied to join the domestic advisory groups and were turned down, which has produced a slightly curious state of affairs that the domestic advisory groups will meet in the Scottish jurisdiction without any representative of the Scottish legal sector. We offered to do a joint seat on behalf of it and share it between ourselves, which we've done in a number of other cases where Scotland only gets one seat on a body. So I just think going forwards, that's another thing which is a dissatisfying outcome that would be good to see changed as the DAGs evolve and time goes on.
Ari, do you want to come?
Just to follow up on a few points. On Mr. Brown's point about trade agreements, I had the invidious position, I suppose, of being on the other side of the table because I was in the EU-Canada DAG. So I was sitting with EU colleagues there, and it takes a long time for these things to deliver results, even where you do have the agreement. And I think, again, this is where SMEs are particularly disadvantaged in some of this. I think the opportunities tend to be there for the bigger companies. So there's some work we have to do, I think, to simplify and to bring in SMEs. A couple of other points. I think we kind of got off to a slow start in terms of the architecture around the TCA. We were, a little bit behind the EU domestic advisory group. But I think, as Adam says, we're gaining ground. We've got visibility. We're beginning to know and understand where the connection points are and who we need to connect into. In regard to Adam's particular point about the Law Society of Scotland, we are very sympathetic to that. Indeed, there's been a recommendation from the Executive Council of the Domestic Advisory Group, which is the two vice-chairs, myself and Steve Turner and the chair, Sean Maguire, to the UK government, that this is a bit of a missed opportunity and that we would like to see it rectified at the earliest possible time. So, you know, I hope that that's something that we can see in the not too distant future. I gather that there's a view that the DAG is already very large, which it is. I mean, the EU DAG has 30 members, and that's 10, 10 and 10, 10 from the business sector, 10 from the sort of trade union professional association sector, and 10 from the NGO third sector. So it's quite a concise group of 30. I think in the UK DAG, we're probably running at the minute about 60. And that is one of the considerations I know around this, that if you open it up, you know, do we have the capacity to go beyond 60? But I certainly think, you know, and it has been a recommendation, convener, from the Executive Council that the Law Society is a particularly special case, and that, you know, there should be means to involve them in the DAG. And of course, it's one of the reasons that we set up the subcommittees, and I think it is important, and that's part of the visibility and you know, the making progress that I think Adam talks about, that we have five subcommittees, and they're not restricted to membership of the DAG. Anyone can join, anyone with an interest can join one of the five subcommittees, and our Nations and Regions one, you know, has quite wide membership out with the DAG itself. So, you know, hopefully that's an opportunity going forward.
We're certainly aware of the issue around the representation. I should also add that I'm a member of the Faculty of Advocates, so particularly aware of that. And I'm sure it's an issue that we'll return to. Can I move to our third sort of chapter, which was around opportunities for further developing the EU UK relationships, really sort of looking to the future. Perhaps if I could ask Arin, because I think your submission touches on the importance of continuous engagement and adaptability, I think is really a significant point. But what's your sense of how the relationship may evolve in the next few years? And we've spoken about the elections and the review, etc. But where are the opportunities, do you think?
I think at civil society level, you know, there are huge opportunities, and I think there's a willingness to engage. As I mentioned at the beginning, convener, we signed a memorandum of understanding with the European Economic and Social Committee, which I suppose is our equivalent, because it is also made up of social partners in terms of business, trade unions and third sector stroke academics. So it sort of mirrors our membership as well. And I think there are huge opportunities through that. And we are the first sub-state to actually sign an MOU like that. And, you know, we don't want to try to do too much too quickly. So our first steps are around youth engagement and youth mobility. And as I say, there's currently an opinion going through the EESC at the minute, which Scotland and Scottish young people have had an opportunity to input to through our conference in November. Myself and John Curtis have been invited to the External Affairs Committee meeting in April to further those discussions. And other areas that we're interested in are around green energy and, you know, citizens' well-being. So it's an iterative and incremental process, I suppose. But for so long, I kind of felt that post the pandemic, we were all kind of sitting in a train station waiting room, and all the trains were passing us by because we were quite fragmented in the sector around civil society. But I feel like we've now got back on the train. I think there's a very positive response from, as I said, the EESC, which is our equivalent, but also from the EU delegation. I think they're very keen to work with us, and I believe there's a trip planned to Scotland in April, and there'll be a meeting with SAFE, and you know, we'll look to develop and expand that cooperation in areas of common interest. I mean, in other areas around things like health, for example, you know, my day job is director of the Health and Social Care Alliance. We have strong partnerships with, for example, the European Union Patient Academy on Therapeutic Innovation, where we've involved academia in Scotland and so on, looking at things like clinical trials and how we can work together to share information and best practice. And we're also members of the European Patient Forum. So I think there are opportunities, but the fact that we now have a kind of way in which we can bring people together and a sort of pathway into things has been a good thing. And I'm sure that others around the table, because we did lose a lot when we left the EU and European funding stopped, as Rachel has said, that had an impact, particularly on the third sector, on communities. But I feel we are beginning to kind of find our feet a little bit and make the connections. I'm very pleased that Enable are joining SAFE. And I think going forward, you know, we now have a forum for discussion and a way in which we can take things forward on a positive basis.
Can I come back on one of the things you mentioned, which is, I mean, you've given us a very clear picture of SAFE and its work and its activity. It's obviously a very vibrant body that is creating and thinking about things. And we also, you know, know about what the DAG does at a UK level. How do you get a sense that on the EU side of things, there is a similar kind of vitality to what's happening and an interest in the issues? You mentioned some engagement. I think Alistair mentioned contact with European universities. Do you get a sense that they are as sort of lively about these issues and interested and engaged?
I think in terms of cooperation and partnership, I do think there's a vibrancy and an interest. I definitely think post-Windsor things have thawed out quite a bit. You'll know that within the sort of architecture around the TCA, there is an opportunity for a civil society forum, a joint civil society forum. We've now had two. The first one, there'll be some people around the table that were at it, was very stage managed, and I think there was general agreement, didn't really take things forward in a positive, constructive way. But the second one, which we had last year in November, October, I think was much better. I think there are differing views, and certainly the European Commission is very much of the view at this point in time, and if you take evidence, I'm sure you'll hear that, that they want a very strict interpretation of things, whereas I think, you know, third sector, academia, trade unions and business groups actually civil society, I think, are, and I suppose it comes back to Miss Forbes' point, you know, I think they are very interested in taking forward that engagement, because we are in a very unique situation. As I say, I sat in the Canada DAG, but I mean, you know, we were members for 50 years. We're near neighbours. Europe is our biggest market. So there are good reasons for us to find partnership opportunities and work together going forward.
I think there's a huge amount of goodwill and desire for ever closer connectedness from partners within the European Union. I mean, as I said, you know, already on the research side, you know, the partners that our universities are working with in Europe, their consistent message to the European Commission is please, 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 let's find a way to keep the UK as close in as it conceivably can be to Horizon, and to basically treat the UK on an equal basis to European member states. And the mobility vitality of interest is actually quite striking as well. I mean, the last time I was on a mission in Brussels talking to people around the Commission, around the Parliament, so many of them had actually been on an Erasmus exchange into the UK and into Scotland, that they were, you know, representing a real hunger to get that restarted, because they felt that this was a bilateral benefit, that actually so much of what we do in Scotland, so much we do in the wider UK, is interesting and valuable and culturally enriching for people coming from the EU, that vitality of bilateral relationship is something that they want to see fully enabled. So I think there are a lot of, particularly post-Windsor, I think there are a lot of extraordinarily open doors building on what I would say is a deep reservoir kind of cultural desire to have the closest possible relationship with Scotland and the UK.
If that's right, and I'm sure it is, why does it appear that the EU only want a kind of short, somewhat technical review of the TCA? Is this not the opportunity for a much more wide-ranging substantive review?
I think that's a huge political question. I guess there's a sort of a degree of fear that once you start unstitching this with a wide range of interest groups and member states, do you end up somewhere actually worse than when you started? But you know, I my general sense is, you know, underneath that, the direction of travel, the momentum is that there are still relationships in many, many levels, politically and culturally and academically, between UK and opinion formers in the EU that create a momentum that actually is meaningfully towards a closer relationship.
I just want to Lloyd. Yeah.
Just following on briefly from Alistair, just from the environmental NGO's point of view, many of our members remain parts of European and international networks, because we recognise that the environmental questions are global and multinational, and we're Scottish Environment Link is still a member of the European Environment Bureau, which has members in all countries on the continent of Europe, not the European Union only, if you see what I mean. But to come back to your part three opening question about opportunities in the future, I think from our point of view, the biggest opportunity is to use the cooperation that the TCA agreement and the review offers to agree and deliver on shared environmental ambitions. I mean, rhetorically, all of the governments in the UK and the EU are kind of do have environmental and climate ambitions that are positive. Whether they're delivering them or not is another question. And I think, therefore, that we would like to see sort of more mechanisms to help that delivery in a cooperative way. Initially, of course, fixing divergence issues, the divergence of chemicals that I've mentioned. So since we left the EU, the UK's added no chemicals to its list of potential substances of very high concern, whereas the EU has added 31. So there are other examples in similar numbers in other categories. And I think a way of addressing that kind of divergence needs to be looked at. And one of our members who specialises in chemicals, ChemTrust, has produced a recent report looking at the Swiss model of how Switzerland regulates chemicals in partnership with the EU, and that might be a model that I think would be worth the UK looking at. And I think that's one opportunity for the future. Another opportunity for the future is the European Environment Agency, which is the agency that deals with environmental data and information and shares that information with governments. It's obviously quite associated with the EU, but it has associate members from virtually every other country in Europe: Iceland, Norway, Switzerland, Serbia, you know, all of those countries are members of the EEA as well. And in recent maps and reports from the EEA, the UK is unfortunately now a black hole or a white hole, if you see what I mean, in terms of environmental issues across Europe. And I see no reason, and I think the Scottish Government would be supportive of that, because officials from Scottish Environment Protection Agency, etc., were previously involved. And, you know, the swapping of data and the comparison of comparing information and ensuring that all of the policy decisions taken by governments and regulators, etc., is based on good data is a crucial part of the environment, and some form of associate membership of the European Environment Agency, I think, would be a very positive move for the UK in the future. Going forward, I think clarifying what maintaining levels of protection in the TCA means, particularly as different the UK and the EU develop new laws in different ways, will be important, how those levels of protection are compared, etc. So since we've left, the EU has moved forward with a nature restoration law. It's also moved forward with a new environmental crime directive, which also includes words to the effect of ecocide. It doesn't actually use the word ecocide, but it uses a phrase that's kind of equivalent to that. And how and if the UK matches those would be an important question. But equally an important question for this place, of course, is that many of these areas of environmental regulation and legislation are devolved, so Scotland has the opportunity to keep pace with those areas of law within Scotland. So I think those are things that Scotland should look at, the opportunities of and matching the ambitions of the EU going forward.
Does anyone else want to come in on the future, as it were, and any quick wins that could be achieved? Yes, Adam.
Just quickly, in terms of, I think the relationship is interesting, sort of between the sort of bars and law societies across Europe. I mean, we are members of the CCBE, which is the sort of big umbrella group for all bars and law societies across the EU. Post-Brexit, we negotiated an associate membership status, which in very short terms means we don't vote on things that are EU only, but there is an awful lot of issues that the CCBE deals with, which we still have a vote. I think the thing I would say is it's actually relatively quite positive, I'd say, for where we thought we might be. We are still participating, our experts are still being asked their opinions. You know, we are still very much involved in this, even if we're not voting on specifically commission-only business, which I think is far better than we had feared it might be at one point. So I think that there is a sort of positive wind in that sort of relationship. And just in terms of easy wins, I still think, you know, as has been mentioned a few times across the board, the mobility area and some of the areas I referred to earlier, the sort of Article 145, 126 areas, but just mobility in general, I think would tidy things up and enable things to be a lot easier. I mean, surprisingly, a lot of members in Europe that I've spoken to have sort of referred to youth mobility. And I think there's a degree of we've got through Brexit and we've sat back now and, well, who's going to follow on from us? Who's the next generation coming through? And I think there is sort of concerns there as well. So I think there's a sort of broad positive bit of work that could be done there.
Actually, the PPA is one of the issues that they've specifically been looking at as well. So it's on their agenda. Yes, Arin, would you like to sort of close for everyone in terms of, unless anyone else wants it? Tom, sorry, Arin, if I can go to Tom first, and then perhaps you could round off the discussion in whatever way you see it, feel fit, feel right. Tom.
I'll give you time to think, Irene, for a minute. Just a couple of very quick points. So one is on implementation. We've talked about, I think in particular, the sanitary and phytosanitary chapter of the TCA does contain a range of useful provisions. I won't go through all of it, but you know, one provision is that there should not be unduly burdensome information requests that might delay access to each other's markets. You know, SPS procedures and measures should be proportionate to risks identified. You know, these are useful provisions if implemented to the letter. And when we think about some of the issues for our small business, in particular around certification, I think that looking back at those provisions would be a useful exercise to do. I mean, it's something we'll be doing anyway, regardless of the review. But for us, that's certainly something to prioritise. Now, then you've got the difference, I guess, between theory and what's in the agreement and then actual practice and how hard it is to get progress on those issues, making use of those provisions. that, I think, probably takes us to this discussion which is out there around agri-food products in general and SPS agreement. And I know that others in the food and drink sector are looking more closely at that, producer perishable products. I think, you know, the devil's in the detail there, but I think it should be looked at, because if there is a, you know, if there's something which could help reduce some of these requests for documentation, then that's got to be a good thing. As I said, devil's in the detail. We've got to look at how UK government, the Scottish government, could continue to regulate as well. But I just mention it because I know it's out there as an idea, and I think it's worth exploring how that would actually work.
Does anyone else want to contribute before I go to Arian? I think colleagues or guests? No. Keith, yes.
Just very briefly, Convener, to say that I really don't know as much about this as I'd like to know, but from the opening comments, it would seem, if the big question is where do we go from here, and there's not a kind of pre-plan based on ideology or whatever else as to where it should go, surely it should just be things which are not currently working, which could work better, a kind of pragmatic approach, although I think Ian's point at the start was that that's changing, is likely to change over the course of the year, but surely it's just look for the pressure points, the friction points just now, and try and deal with those as a suggestion.
Right, Arian, the pressure is on, so if you can close the conversation.
A few points that I felt was important just to pick up, Convener, because I think we've discussed, you know, the EU's approach to this and that it's technical. I think it's worthwhile mentioning that there is a joint statement from the EU-UK DAG, and it's important to reflect the language in that, and that language does talk about things like, you know, rights-based human rights, employment rights, citizens. And so these sit slightly out with that sort of technical approach. So I think there is some common accord between the EU and the UK DAG, which is maybe a little bit different from, you know, the Commission position. And I suppose that is understandable for a number of reasons, that, you know, Brexit was a long, difficult process, and, you know, as someone else said, there's probably a bit of a reluctance to go back and undo some of that on the Commission's part. And also, you know, Europe's moving forward, as one of my colleagues said as well. You know, they're busy with the candidate countries and the war in the Ukraine, and so there are other big pressing issues, and no doubt they'll be looking at their own elections this year and the elections in the USA. So some of these big ticket things are around and about, and as I did say at the beginning, will influence things over the year. I mean, the way we're approaching the Nations and Regions Subcommittee report is to think about things in layers. And so we're thinking about what would require an absolute change to the TCA, what could be done by mutual agreement, and we've spoken quite a lot about that today, Convener, and what would require a bit of work in terms of, you know, domestic policies and relationships with the UK government. And I think all of those three areas are important, and two-thirds of them don't require changes to the TCA. So I think, you know, that's all to the good. In terms of summing up, I'd like to thank you and the committee for giving us the opportunity today, and I hope what we've done, Convener, is brought the voice of stakeholders, of business, of the third sector, but also of people, and that, you know, we've raised some issues that are important to people and citizens. And I think we bring that democratic perspective, you might say, because we are all working in communities, whether it's geographic, thematic and sectoral communities, and it's great for us to have an opportunity to come along and speak to the committee. We've been in operation for, I meant to check the dates and I didn't, but I think it's roughly about 9 months. So I think we've achieved quite a bit in that time, and we've built a broad stakeholder group, and I hope that we can continue. We'll keep a close eye, and I hope that we can continue discussions, Convener. And also just to say that from the perspective of the UK DAG, we're going to be holding the next meeting in Scotland. That's written into the terms of reference that the DAG will rotate amongst devolved nations, and so the next one will be in Scotland in April. And at a recent discussion with the convener and the other vice chair from the trade union sector, we felt if there was an opportunity, I don't know how diaries and you know, parliamentary days and so on will coincide, but we would be very keen, whether it's a private session or a public session, to meet with the committee at that point as the UK DAG, because obviously today I'm here in a safe capacity. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for that. Thank you very much for that, Arian. I'm sure that that's something that we can take up with the clerks of the committee, if that's a possibility. Can I just thank you and everyone for attending this morning? It's been a very wide-ranging discussion, and as I think you know, this is our first sort of scene-setting evidence session in our inquiry, so it's been incredibly useful. So thank you very much, and can I now formally close the meeting? Thank you.